Hey there, it's Mark Pagan from Radiotopia Presents, and I want to tell you about a new series from our fellow Radiotopia show, Radio Diaries. It's called The Unmarked Graveyard. In the waters off New York City, there's a narrow strip of land called Hart Island. More than a million people are buried there in mass graves with no headstones. Over the next few weeks, the award-winning team at Radio Diaries will be untangling mysteries from America's largest public cemetery.
Neil Harris was last seen in Inwood, New York on December 12th.
So many questions, man. So many questions.
You can't help but wonder what her life has been.
I never went back and I never looked for him again.
Subscribe to Radio Diaries wherever you get your podcasts.
From Mermaid Palace and Radiotopia, welcome to the heart. I'm Caitlin Prest. So what I promised is the second episode of The Shadows, which is a serialized story about a diehard romantic who falls in love with a diehard realist. And as I sat down to write, nothing was coming. I found myself incapable of of thinking about doing anything right now that isn't about Palestine. Everybody that I know is hurting about this. My friend Ollie, whose grandfather left Jerusalem in 1948, their family home houses settlers today. Ollie lives in Qatar and texted our friend group links to buy journalists eSIM cards that will work in the midst of the electricity and internet shutdowns.
I think what I'm feeling today is a reckoning that the grief that I've been experiencing over the last month almost has undoubtedly had a severe impact on the way that I view the world.
My friend Mahika, who's from India, living in New York,
with the backdrop of what's happening in Palestine, it's been feeling really, really, really hard. This is a fucking shit show.
My friend Max.
I am an American Jew who grew up in a not staunchly, but still a Zionist household, right? And I grew up with being taught that Israel was there to keep Jews safe. And there's not a fucking thing that has happened in my entire life that that place has done or the people who support it have done that have ever made me feel safer. None of this makes anybody safer.
My friend Rosa, she lives in Athens now. I met her in the intro classes of a political science degree that I didn't finish back when I thought that that was how I was going to give my heart to the world. She kept with it and went all the way into working in humanitarian aid.
Yeah, just the sheer logistics of getting aid in, that's very controlled by Israel. The amount of water they let go in, if they actually, hypothetically, if they distributed that to everybody that is alive now in Gaza, everybody gets 0.5, 50 milliliters. Of water, and the global standard of the minimum amount of water a person needs a day is 15 liters. And that's just a global humanitarian sphere standard.
My friend Shawnee, who I talked about two episodes ago, the composer and sound designer for The Shadows and Movies in Your Head, she lives in Tel Aviv and she's writing to me telling me that her friends are getting the shit kicked out of them for voicing dissent.
So I am sending this with a newborn feeding on my chest, and it's pitch black.
My friend Becky, who lives in Australia, just had a baby.
I can't stop thinking about the mothers.
We failed, plain and simple. And I'm not even talking about from a geopolitical or human rights perspective how much we failed Palestine and the Palestinian people. I say it as a humanitarian who's worked in a variety of conflict-affected communities in the height of crisis, trying to figure out how to get assistance to those in need when they need it the most.
And the mothers who are pregnant.
I'm ashamed to call myself a humanitarian right now.
The both sides of them just like can't wrap its head around the fact that just like it just feels like gaslighting on just like the most massive scale and fucked, you know, like when is enough?
Now we see it so vividly and it makes me a bit ashamed of how distant we all were about it before now.
I'm sorry to the Palestinians that we can't do anything other than to raise the voice of Palestinians and their history and protect some sense of humanity.
My heart is like breaking.
I decided to scrap what I thought I was going to put out this week and create this episode that is just processing what's going on, offering a moment to breathe, reflect, pray, meditate, and grapple with the question of what to do. Some housekeeping before we begin. This episode is not a deep dive. I made it recording on Halloween and then edited it in a couple of days. I don't get into nitty-gritties about the conflict or the history or why I take the stance that I do. I'm speaking in general terms about matters of the soul, the larger significance of what these events mean for our humanity, what it means to be a bystander, and what hope there could be for anyone who wants to do something to make the violence stop. I will not explain my position. I will not complicate what this is. I will speak from an uncomplicated stance that what's happening is genocide. And if it feels complicated for you, I can understand why. My invitation is to listen all the way through and use this as a way of exploring what you think, how you feel, even if you disagree with me. While I spend most of the time in this episode speaking to people in my position, people on the outside of this, for all of you out there who are Palestinian and have roots going back to Palestine, my heart is with you, first and foremost. My heart is with you. Watching the world be confused, missing the point, playing devil's advocate, is another trauma on top of the trauma of what this has been for decades, and the new trauma of what it has become. So now we begin with a moment of silence, a moment of prayer for all of the people, the children, the lovers, the teenagers, the mothers, the fathers, the grandparents, the kids, the babies that are afraid for their lives right now in this very moment, that are fighting for their lives right now in this very moment. Close your eyes. Open your heart. Send those people love, strength. Now I want you to send that love, those prayers, and that strength to the people who have the power to stop this. Send them the strength to turn the ship around. We have the power to stop this. I have spent a lot of my adulthood making up excuses not to feel things like this. When I read about or watch news footage of atrocities that are happening far away, I gave myself the excuse to ignore it or avoid it because I felt like it wouldn't be fair to all of the other atrocities happening in the world to care about one of them. And if I started caring about one thing that was happening far away, I would have to care about all the things that were happening far away. And it just seemed like too much. I'm filled with emotion that I don't know what to do with, and all of the things that I try to do seem like they don't work. Protesting, calling government officials, donating money. I think that I'm powerless. I let all of those feelings, all of those thoughts stop me from opening my heart. And today, I'm deciding to overcome my cynicism and my false sense of powerlessness. This time, I decided that I was going to open my heart and I was going to feel this, read the headlines, that I was going to watch the news, that I was going to listen to what's happening. There's something about this one that feels like it's about everything. I started out by liking all of the posts from the feeds that I was already following so that more content that's against the genocide would show up in my feed. This is from Official Jake Gyllenhaal. Official Jake Gyllenhaal. It's a funny Instagram handle. This post put into words what I've been feeling.
Palestinian liberation is not just for Palestinians. It is about queer liberation. It is about Black liberation. It is about liberation for all people of color. It is about liberation for all genders. It is also about Jewish liberation. Queer Palestinians, queer non-Palestinians, we are also doing this work. I have plenty of videos that you can watch about this. Over 2 million Palestinians are being carpet bombed as we speak. We are paying for those bombs, and all forms of communications and internet have been cut off. We don't really know what's happening there. U.S.-backed Israeli airstrikes are carpet bombing, massacring who knows how many people right now, and we aren't just letting it happen, we are making it happen. So yes, you are complicit and you are responsible to end this today.
We're not just letting it happen. We're making it happen. This is more than just an international conflict far away. This is about the lie that we tell about what the West is, what the United States is. This is extermination. This is genocide. This is about white supremacy, the ugliest and most dangerous and evil and violent expression of white supremacy. This is about a way of being in the world that we're trying to grow out of. Domination, coercion, flexes of power, clinging to power. Do we really want to live in a world where the people who are the most powerful will justify anything to maintain their dominance? What does that mean for our humanity? Those of us who live in the places that benefit from that dominance. This is about what white people can get away with. At the same time, this is about trauma. This is about the great burden that any population or person that experiences intergenerational trauma that originates from a historic atrocity. It's about the burden of healing that trauma without passing it on. We are standing at the edge of a precipice. This precipice is our humanity, our hearts, all of us who live in the countries that benefit from being world dominators, This is about what kind of violence we're willing to overlook in order to enjoy our comfortable lives. This is another thing that I saw on Instagram that stood out to me. This is Dr. Norman Finkelstein in 2009.
My late father was in Auschwitz concentration camp. My late mother was in Majdanek concentration camp. Every single member of my family on both sides was exterminated. Both of my parents were on the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising. And it's precisely and exactly because of the lessons my parents taught me and my two siblings that I will not be silent when Israel commits its crimes against the Palestinians. And I consider nothing more despicable than to use their suffering and their martyrdom to try to justify the torture, the brutalization, the demolition of homes that Israel daily commits against the Palestinians. So I refuse any longer to be intimidated or browbeaten by the tears. If you had any heart in you, you would be crying for the Palestinians, not for what's been done.
If you're listening to this and you're Jewish and you're kind of struggling because of things that you were taught growing up or intergenerational trauma, I highly recommend reading my friend Rachel Ricketts's book. I've talked about it a few times on the show. It's called Do Better. It's not about Israel-Palestine. It is about white supremacy culture, and it's focused on anti-Black racism. What I found impactful about the book is that it talks about being an oppressed oppressor, having an identity that holds intergenerational trauma, that holds painful histories, really painful histories, and reconciling those painful histories and that intergenerational trauma with an oppressor identity. And it's not easy. It's not an easy thing to reconcile those two things. If you're struggling with that, please read her book. It'll help, I think. Before the ad break, which is coming up, one more moment of reflection. After the break, a look at the power that we, the regular-ass people who live in North America and other countries that are not Palestine, the power that we have to change this outcome. A moment of reflection. I watched a very cool horror movie today. It just so happens to be Halloween. By the time you listen to this, it will not be Halloween anymore. But if you like Halloween-y kind of scary movies, I highly recommend this one. It's called Assassination Nation. And in it, one of the characters says, 10% of people are cruel. 10% of people are merciful. And the other 80% can be swayed either way. When I feel so overwhelmed about violence that is happening that feels far away from my day-to-day life, there's a quote that I always come back to. It's actually from the Talmud, which is a Jewish sacred text. Do not be daunted by the enormity of the world's grief. Do justly now. Love mercy now. Walk humbly now. You are not obligated to complete the work, but neither are you free to abandon it. And we're back. Now the question that many of us are asking, what power do I really have? What can I do? What will make a difference? I started listening to Al Jazeera again, and I found this podcast episode that helped me. In it, you're going to hear Maliha Lodi, who served as Pakistan's ambassador to the United Kingdom, the United States, and the United Nations, Ronnie Kasrils, former South African government minister, and Hanan Ashrawi, a Palestinian political leader, and the host is James Bays. It's a panel, and I'm going to let it run for about 15 minutes. Please listen to the whole thing. It really helped me. I think it'll help you too. After this, some reflections on power and responsibility, some resources for taking action, and a closing meditation / manifestation exercise that I would love for you to do with me. This is from The Inside Story. The title of the episode is What Influence Could International Opinion Have on Gaza? In it, they're talking about a vote that the General Assembly did that was 2/3 in favor of a ceasefire in Gaza. And they're also talking about the Security Council. The Security Council is made up of 15 countries and the colonial countries mostly, and they vetoed the recommendation.
Ambassador Lodi, Maliha, can I ask you first about the General Assembly? Tell me why the General Assembly is important.
I think the General Assembly is important because when there's a deadlock in the Security Council, as we saw when several resolutions didn't get through, which were aimed at stopping the bloodshed or at least getting a humanitarian pause, then the General Assembly kicks in. It's often called the parliament of the world, where every country has one vote. And that's a body that really does reflect global opinion. The Security Council, after all, is only made up of 15 members. But the General Assembly, with 193 members, does demonstrate what the world is thinking. And I think what we saw in this resolution and the vote for the resolution was where the world was standing. It was standing on the right side of history. It was conveying that it wants an end to the bloodshed, to the carnage, to the genocide that is going on. And it was a rebuke to those members of the Security Council who used the veto, the United States primarily, to prevent any kind of a ceasefire or any kind of a pause in the fighting. So I think, okay, so the resolution is non-binding. But I think the force of public opinion and global opinion is extremely important.
Okay, Hanan Ashrawi, if I can talk to you about the resolution itself. It took a lot of negotiation led by Jordan of the Arab group. Let me just read out what it called for. An immediate, durable and sustained humanitarian truce. But it also called for humanitarian aid to come in. Immediate, continuous, sufficient and unhindered. And interestingly, it specified what should go in. Water, food, medical supplies, fuel and electricity. This would be, would it not, for the Palestinian people, wonderful if this was actually complied with?
Yeah, I wouldn't say it's wonderful, but it would be beginning to undo the horrendous injustice and damage and violence that has been inflicted on the Palestinians of Gaza in terms of ending Israel's genocidal siege and prevention of all normal requirements of an ordinary life, frankly speaking. So, yes, it should have taken place. It shouldn't be even under question or doubt. And it's very tragic that the superpowers, particularly in the West, give themselves the right to take decisions over the life and death of 2 million Palestinians. This is incredible.
Ronnie, when we saw that vote, and it's done with electronic voting in the UN General Assembly, it was really a snapshot of international opinion and where each country stands. Every single ambassador and representative had to say where they stood on the war in Gaza. Were you surprised by the way the vote went?
No, not at all, because we've seen over months and years what world opinion's about, and we've seen the enormous response to this gross criminality of Zionist Israel and the support the United States and others give it. So one was not surprised. I was very pleased to see that we had a two-third majority. And it showed the Palestinian people, the people of Gaza, that they are not alone, that the world stands by them.
This is a very strong message to Washington. The message is very clear. The world wants the bloodshed to stop. And President Biden, by encouraging Israel, is really becoming complicit in what is going on. And I think that's how world opinion is going. It's not just in the General Assembly. You look at the streets, not just the Arab street. You look at streets across the world. One of the largest demonstrations has taken place in London. There have been large demonstrations in my country, Pakistan. So I think the message should be responded to. And I think the United States should shift course now and take the side of peace and justice.
What the global South clearly see is that duplicity of the former colonial powers with the USA, the imperialist power that wants to master and dominate the world, that this shines through. You can see the millions are so outraged at this absolute slaughter that the USA and the EU states, those Western powers, are party to. They are criminals. And we must find a way to also ensure that they know where we stand and that we're not going to go along with their game. It's vital now. It's crucial.
Malia, I want to bring you in on this and the whole idea of double standards and the West, because you have a unique perspective. Not only were you Pakistan's ambassador to the United Nations, you were also Pakistan's ambassador to the United States, and you were ambassador, actually it's called High Commissioner, to the United Kingdom. So give us your perspective.
I think it's long been known that the West, or the US-led West, has practiced double standards. They talk about human rights in countries that they are opposed to, but they don't really show much concern for human rights. I mean, in my neighborhood, my country's neighborhood, there is the issue of occupied Kashmir, which, like Palestine, is an occupied territory and has also seen huge violations of human rights. But we've not heard any sound or any comment from Western countries about these violations. So I think what this will do is to bring into much sharper relief the kind of double standards and hypocrisy that many Western countries, I think it would be unfair to club all Western countries together. Some have stood for Palestine, for example. Ireland, I think it's taken a very courageous position. So I think one has to be a little careful. But I will say that what it does reinforce is the shift in global influence from the US-led Western bloc of countries to the rest.
Ronnie, let me bring up what actually seems to have happened on the ground in Gaza. In addition to the water being cut, the electricity being cut, no fuel coming in, very limited aid coming in, now it seems that Gaza is going black to the world. The cell phone services, internet services have been cut. What do you make of this latest blow by Israel to the people of Gaza?
Well, it's all part of the master plan. They want to cut Gaza out of the world entirely. They want to black it out. So this is what their game is, totally. But I believe that the world voice, together with the Samud, the resistance of the Palestinian people, will prevent that happening.
Maliha, consequences of the internet and phones being cut off means that people cannot ring for ambulances. It means that UN agencies, aid agencies can't speak to their staff. They can't do their work. Journalists cannot report and get the news out. As a former ambassador to the UN, do you believe these are additional war crimes by Israel?
Oh, there's no doubt about it. I think Israel has been committing war crimes for over 50 years, if not more. But what it is doing now, I think it has completely defied international opinion. And what is going on is the kind of bloodshed that I think in modern history, we have not really witnessed this before. Plus, I think we also must look at the consequences for those countries that have been backing Israel, that have been going on and on not caring about the people dying and the civilians who are dying in the thousands in Gaza, but they've been going on and on about Israel's right to defend itself. Defend itself. This is defense where you're taking the lives of innocent people. I think there will be consequences for these countries. They're already confronting a crisis of credibility, of humanity. And actually, I think their own people, certainly, if you look at some of the demonstrations which are going on in cities in the United States itself, you'll see that public opinion there also is watching with horror and anguish about how their own government is encouraging a country that is carrying out ethnic cleansing by millions of people are being affected by this.
Hanan, can I bring you in on that point that Maliha has made about protest around the world? Because we've seen very, very large protests taking place all over the world. In fact, we saw one in Grand Central Station, very near the UN, which was Jewish people campaigning to stop the war. Do you think these protests are going to have an effect, maybe even more of an effect than a vote in the UN General Assembly?
Certainly, yes, Jim, certainly they will have an effect because the Jewish Voice for Peace and If Not Now are two organizations that have been active for some time, including others Jewish organizations that we have worked with for years. I remember before we used to call for a demonstration or a protest with 20, 30 people. Now you have thousands. They went into the Capitol, into Congress, the occupied Congress. They went into Grand Central Station in the thousands, and they made a tremendous spectacle, and they gave the Palestinians a sense of enormous support that you are not alone, that the Jewish people of conscience are standing with you. This is very important because Israel wants to claim that it stands for all, it speaks on behalf of all Jews and so on, and that all Jews are Zionists or all Jews share in its genocidal policies, but that's not true. And they stood out and they stood on the side of justice. Now, that impact will not only be felt in Israel, but it is being felt clearly in the U.S. I mean, look at the public opinion polls. The ratings of Biden have gone down enormously as a result of his blind support of Israel and his embrace of these war crimes and his entering into a partnership with these war crimes. And I think ultimately the International Criminal Court should look at these things, not just at the Israeli perpetrators, but at their partners and supporters and enablers in the West.
Let me bring in Ronnie quickly. Ronnie, we don't have much time left, but people power, how important do you think it can be at this point?
Well, just recall what happened in the struggle against apartheid South Africa. Rather similar. The South African government wanted to ignore all the resolutions, the United Nations and the protests around the world. It built up to an incredible torrent of people's power and in South Africa itself. And one cannot underestimate the power of international solidarity, the power in the streets, the power to pressurize governments like the US, like France, UK. We had the same opponents in our struggle against apartheid. And in the end, they were forced to buckle. So this is a very important weapon, a peaceful weapon, a highly active, militant weapon. And we'll do everything possible to mobilize the forces that are growing and growing. And we will succeed in the end. Palestine will live for sure.
Listening to this helped me feel more certain that the one thing I can do is publicly and loudly and constantly say that this is not okay. It could actually make a difference. If you are white and if you're North American from, you know, the colonialist countries, let's just fucking say it, the colonialist countries. If you're white and you are from a colonialist country, you have proximity to the powers that are making this happen. to say that we are powerless, to say that I am powerless, to look, to say, to feel apathetic or overwhelmed about what to do, it's absurd. It is our job to counteract and repair the violence that affords us our ill-gotten privilege. It is our job to use that privilege to convince the white people who are part of the 10% cruel and 80% swayable to stop the violence. This is a moment for you to speak up. This is a moment for you to take a stand. Your voice matters in this. A manifestation exercise. I believe in the power of manifestation. I believe in the power of large groups of people believing in something, praying for something. I believe that what we're able to imagine isn't intangible, that what we're able to imagine actually often turns into something tangible. For example, the fact that sci-fi writers on Star Trek basically imagine cell phones and iPads into existence. I've been talking to Joe Biden in my head. I've been imagining a possibility. And I'd like for you to imagine this with me. He's looking in a mirror at his own eyes. A rare moment has opened up where for some reason he feels a sense of distance from the people and the government that he sees every day, all of the people who surround him that support his decision to back this violence, all of the people he would disappoint if he decided to oppose it. Distance from the specter of the geopolitical and tactical reasons for supporting this war, the domino effect of what pulling out would mean for diplomatic relationships and financial relationships. Somehow, all of that feels far away. The mountain he climbed to become the president of the most powerful country in the world and the sense of importance that that affords him feels far away. He looks into his own eyes and sees a man. A man who believes that he's good. A man who got into politics for good reasons. And suddenly everything that felt complicated becomes simple. A moment of extreme clarity comes over him. He says to himself, I'm going to stop this. That's going to be my legacy. I'm going to stop the violence. Suddenly, he realizes how much support he'll have to do this. He realizes that he will be championed and adored. He washes his hands and walks out to speak to the people on his team that he knows have been silently hoping he would make this call. And with their support, he announces it to the world. And then everything that needs to happen to stop this begins to set itself in motion. So let's have a moment of hoping, of believing, honestly, believing that that can happen, believing that it can happen tomorrow, it can happen next week, it can happen now, it can happen today, it can happen in a couple of hours. Imagine that it's already happened. To close out the show, a track from MC Abdul, who started rapping when he was a kid. He's 15 now. You can check out his stuff on YouTube.
I'm exhausted. Last night I couldn't sleep, but when I did, I could hear bombs in my dreams. Nightmare situation. How could they be so evil? Making mortars out of children and innocent people. We expect the bombs, not knowing where next. Huddle in the corner of my room, trying to protect my little brother as the building shakes like it's possessed. But nothing stronger than the will of the oppressed. I bomb back with my lyrics and rhymes, living the times, trying to break the Palestinian minds. What's hiding in the clouds hanging over my head? My dad risks his life outside to buy bread. The fourth war in my 12th year. At this stage I'm numb, though I haven't feel scared. There's nothing I can do in this case to stay safe. I'm brave, even though this house could be in my grave. I want freedom for the population. 2 million prisoners living in this location, shouting at the wall, but nothing is ever changing. That's life under an occupation. I want freedom for the population. 2 million prisoners living in this location, shouting at the wall, but nothing is ever changing. That's life under an occupation. Mothers mourn, frightened with grief. White sheets covered by his death. Lie on the streets, buildings turn to ash, but my mind is made of steel. So it doesn't take much for me to heal. Won't lose the will to live or lose our minds. My auntie lost her home, so she lost her life. But she is still alive, but traumatized by the bombs that flew in and dropped at night. My sister couldn't sleep, tried to stop her cries. I said it was fireworks, I was telling her lies. Where's the compassion? This is heartless. It's like they want us all living in darkness. Cutting off water and electricity for hours. They're knocking towers, but that's not knocking the power that I have in my pen. When I'm writing, I'm unstoppable. The microphone is the only escape possible, cause that's the way that I can speak my mind. I wonder how does the fighter pilot sleep at night, knowing he can turn the city upside down all of a sudden, slaughtering families with the push of a button. I want freedom for the population. 2 million prisoners living in this location, shouting at the wall, but nothing is ever changing. That's life under an occupation. I want freedom for the population. 2 million prisoners living in this location, shouting at the wall, but nothing is ever changing. That's life under an occupation.
That was MC Abdul. Yep, so this is this episode. It's just me processing this historic atrocity that's happening right now. Next week, there will be more audio fiction, love story, escapism. So they mention JVP, which is the Jewish Voice for Peace. On their website, it says, "We have a plan to end U.S. support for Israel's oppression of Palestinians. Jewish Voice for Peace is the largest progressive Jewish anti-Zionist organization in the world. They are a grassroots, multiracial, cross-class, intergenerational movement of U.S. Jews in solidarity with Palestinian freedom struggle. If you've been looking for a political home for Jews on the left in this perilous moment, if you've been wanting a Jewish community with justice at the center, if you've been looking to turn your rage and grief into meaningful, strategic action, they say, join us. You belong here." Yeah, they have a section where it's called Take Action, and it says, "Urgent, demand a ceasefire now. Millions of lives depend on it." And then they have links that you can click on to take action in different ways. So, JVP, JewishVoiceForPeace.org. There's resources and links in the show notes. So, please take care. Take care, take care, take care. Between the time that I recorded this on Halloween and the time that I'm putting it out on Saturday night, the day of a national protest that happened here in Canada, Joe Biden did order a pause, a humanitarian pause, and there has not been a ceasefire ordered. But if we are loud enough, he will make the ceasefire happen. If we are loud enough.
United will never be defeated. The people united will never be defeated. People united will never be defeated. The people united will never be defeated.
Radiotopia.